Saturn's moon Enceladus is among the best chances for detecting microbial life in the solar system other than here on Earth. Like the similar moon Europa, these ice shell moons show clear interaction between their surfaces and the oceans located beneath the ice. This comes in the form of plumes, spraying water into space, but also surface features that show that these worlds are almost craterless, meaning that they get resurfaced periodically due to water from the ocean beneath making it to the surface and erasing everything, at least briefly. There are other ice shell moons in the solar system that show this kind of surface geology, and some that do not, yet are suspected of harboring oceans much deeper below their frozen surfaces. But in the case of Europa and Enceladus, this water is shallow enough to spray into space through cracks, geysers, effectively making their oceans much more accessible for life searches than the other ice shell moons. You basically fly your spacecraft through the plumes and take samples and see what's there, which is on the agenda for NASA and the world's space agencies. But studying the compositions of the chemicals dissolved in those ice shell oceans is much easier as we already have a dataset from several different past exploratory spacecraft. One such spacecraft was Cassini, a NASA flagship mission to Saturn. That mission ended nearly 15 years ago when Cassini ran out of fuel and was sent on a deliberate crash course to burn up in Saturn's atmosphere to avoid any collisions within its moon system, avoiding any potential contamination. But the mountain of data it collected over its years of operation in the Saturn system is still proving useful and surprising. This time it's the discovery of a key element for life, phosphorus. This is the rarest of the six elements that our brand of life is based on and absolutely requires. There may be other possible biochemistries that replace phosphorus with arsenic, but chemically speaking, it's just not as good. And despite some past claims that didn't pan out, we do not see this kind of life on Earth. This is a huge problem in a broader sense. Phosphorus may well be the Achilles heel for life, so much so that the lack of it is in itself a strong potential solution to the Fermi paradox. Not enough phosphorus, no dice for life. There are a number of associated problems with phosphorus. The first is that some evidence shows, though it's not yet supported with a huge sampling, that phosphorus is rare and spotty in the Milky Way. Some areas seem to have little of it, which may mean that those areas cannot support life. If that turns out to be the case, then it's no wonder we see the Great Silence, and we do not see alien civilizations everywhere. They might be rare just because phosphorus-rich systems are rare. This would mean that the search for life outside Earth really translates to follow the phosphorus. As an aside, phosphorus scarcity is already a problem here on Earth, and it has been since at least the 19th century, when countries had to start importing bone meal and many other things to get phosphorus into depleted soil. While carbon rules the roost as far as life on Earth, it's interesting to compare nitrogen and phosphorus, because they can deplete in the soil very readily. If you don't have nitrogen and phosphorus, you don't have the basis of proteins, and you don't have the scaffolding of DNA, respectively, which limits life. Nitrogen isn't an issue. It runs out quickly, but the atmosphere is about 80% nitrogen, so it can either be artificially fertilized or put back into the soil by the right microbes that can fix nitrogen. You can even rotate crops and do things like plant symbiotic plants, like beans, that carry those nitrogen-fixing microbes with them. Phosphorus, however, has no such trick on Earth. You have to wait for fertilizer or geology. So either the Earth crushes and dissolves phosphorus in the environment on its own, or we do. And even when it does that, a pretty solid fraction of it reacts and isn't available to biology. This issue has been known for a long time. Isaac Asimov was making the point back in the 1950s that phosphorus is life's bottleneck. In fact, it's still a mystery within astrobiology and the origins of life as to just how life on Earth managed to scrounge up just enough phosphorus to get going and keep going. The potential answers to that range all over. Some theories say that it might have come from meteorites, initially, in some local impact with a phosphorus-rich meteorite that unusually increased the levels where abiogenesis was favored, wherever that may be. Yet others say it had to be lakes where the phosphorus collected. We just don't know, but there had to be abundant phosphorus for the magic to happen at all. And back to Enceladus. Cassini had made a number of passes through the geysers of Enceladus. While not ideal for the job, it was able to take some measurements. Scientists sifting through the mountain of data from Cassini and other sources found that the key constituents of life were present. These included carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur, and oxygen. We also know that sugars and amino acids are easy to make, as shown by the Miller-Urey experiments, where you put in the nutrients, simulate the atmosphere of early Earth, add an energy source, and out come the nutrients of life. We also find amino acids, the building blocks of life, in meteorites. The stuff of life is everywhere. We see organic compounds pervading the universe. Only phosphorus stands as a question. What was missing at Enceladus, however, was phosphorus. That element teams up with sugars to form the skeleton of DNA, and the process for just how DNA came about on Earth is still yet another great mystery. But you at least need the constituent parts, and here's the good news. Recent findings based on the Cassini dataset have shown that Enceladus has plenty of phosphorus. In fact, it's in crazy high amounts based on interpretations of the Cassini data. Its oceanic phosphorus content is 500 times greater than that of Earth's oceans. So that's it. Enceladus now satisfies the biggest obstacle, as far as the chemical components of life. If you have phosphorus, you've got the gasoline to run the car, as it were. But there are some things that might cast some questions on this. The detections were not actually from a plume directly, but Saturn's E-ring, which is strongly thought to be generated by Enceladus's plumes. But that's not completely proven, and the dynamics of it aren't completely understood. Still, plumes are the likely culprit. But as it turns out, it's a good form of phosphorus. It's orthophosphate, which organisms can use for growth. It's interesting because these findings actually contradict an earlier model that suggested that Enceladus' oceans would be depleted of phosphorus. Though the author of that paper was actually among the first to say that these new findings are a game changer, and they happily overturned his hypothesis. Honest science at work indeed, that's how we learn and progress. So here's another oddity about Enceladus. It seems that orthophosphate would dissolve at a much higher rate in Enceladus's ocean than anyone previously thought. This could literally be the phosphorus moon, an Earth the phosphorus poor restricted life world, to the tune of having 1,000 times less bioavailable phosphorus than Enceladus has. But this also all but confirms that Enceladus's oceans are in contact with bedrock and are dissolving chemicals from it. Previous evidence has also strongly suggested volcanic vents are doing it. But there remains a huge question and an even bigger mystery, not often discussed outside of the depths of the history of discussion within astrobiology. The question is, we don't actually know how old Enceladus is. Here we have conflicting data. In 2016, a paper focused on the dynamics of the orbits of Saturn's moons showed that they should not be as they are due to tidal effects for any satellites inward of Titan in the Saturn system. This would mean that all of those moons, including Enceladus, are young, perhaps forming as little as 100 million years ago. It's worth noting here that Saturn's rings are transient, thought to only be about 400 million years old, and will be gone in about another 100 million years. Geologically speaking, things happen in the Saturn system. On the other hand, there is some evidence that Enceladus's ocean is at least a billion years old. Well, long enough for life to have arisen there, so far as we know. So pick your contradictory data set on that one. But within this lies an even bigger, very obscure mystery. Take a look at Enceladus's cracks. These are presumably made up of material that welled up from the ocean below and onto the surface. It looks like blue ice, not unlike what you might see in Arctic regions here on Earth. And you find microbial life in those regions. But look carefully at the cracks on Europa. These again seem to be due to the same processes. Two very similar ice shell moons should look roughly the same. But why the dramatic difference in coloration? This is an open question because we don't actually know what's causing that, or what it's made of. We do know that Europa is as old as the solar system, 4.6 billion years. It's had as much time to develop life as Earth had. Enceladus, maybe not. Rewind to 2002. Planetary geologist Brad Dalton looked at the infrared signature of the staining and did a comparison with algae that thrive around hot springs here on Earth. The signatures were similar, so he subjected a variety of earthly microorganisms to conditions similar to that of Europa in a lab here on Earth. Again, The infrared signatures were similar to the Europa staining, but not exactly an infrared. Some have suggested that mixtures of salts might be the culprit, but no combination of salts has ever produced the results. But here's the oddity. In the visible light spectrum, the staining just so happens to be the same color as a very prominent Earth bacterium, E. coli. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently giving another shout out to the sleep crowd. Imagine how awesome that is. Make videos on something you're passionate about, and along the way help a whole lot of people defeat insomnia. Trust me, I deal with it too. And as my parents used to say long ago, JMG, why don't you do something productive? I was 40 when they said that, and then I found YouTube. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.